Oh, it's gonna come over to you. Good morning from the Kansas City Zoo. We've got a friend here. In fact, we've got many friends here. I'm joined by Jessica. We are here at the Learning Den, deep within the confines of the zoo. And this is Bubba, right?
This is Bubba, yeah. He's a common boa constrictor. As you can see, he's our largest snake that we have here at the Zoo Learning Den. He's about 30 pounds and almost about 8 feet long.
Wow, he likes to move around quite a bit,
too.
He
does, yes.
So tell us a little bit about him.
Well, he is actually utilized on assembly programs, so we take them off ground, some of our animals in the building, to go to school programs, and they've been at Royals games and all sorts of fun stuff for different events. He's also utilized in our mixed species show daily at 10:30 a.m. in our auditorium at the front of the zoo, so guests can come see him on grounds as well.
It's really neat, and if you've never held a boa constrictor before...
They're pretty strong.
Yeah, right? Really, really strong. It's just all muscle, and it kind of feels... I remember we met Louise, a boa, a few weeks
that's
ago,
right, kind
of
yeah.
Same idea. They said like a garden hose that's been turned on.
Yeah, Louise is much larger than what Bubba is. They actually get her out sometimes and do a wait in front of the public for kind of a big wow moment for everybody to see. So she's much larger than him, and she's actually in our snake building near the Discovery Zone area.
Okay.
If you want to check her out.
But a lot of the animals that are here in the Learning Den today...
Yes.
Kind of live in this area, right? And
yes.
They go out to the schools.
Yep, that's right. So we do have different ways that we take them. We have instructors that go off grounds and know kind of the animal experts and know a lot about the different snakes and the different animals that we have. So not just Bubba, we have about 8 or 9 different types of snakes in the building, anywhere from a small sand boa all the way up to about his size. So
nice.
Kind of a wide variety that kids can learn about and kind of get to see them up close and personal and know snakes aren't slimy, right? They're not gross,
no.
Wet. They're just really smooth. Their scales are made of keratin, just like our fingernails or hair are made out
okay.
of. So if you feel them, it kind of almost feels like a smooth
yeah.
fingernail. And their scales do only grow one way, just down head to tail. And that way we do teach our kids that they can pet them. So we teach them they can pet head to tail, not the other way, because that kind of feels like someone pulling up on your fingernail.
Oh, yeah. That's kind of neat. The best part about today's episode of ZooView is that we get to see not one, not two. I think we've got quite a few animals that we can choose from to show you guys. So we're going to give Bubba away to
there we go.
Kelly there. And so best part about ZooView, of course, is that it's interactive and we're live on Facebook right now. So if you have any questions for us, send them and I'll be checking my cell phone here throughout the afternoon or the morning. And we just got a question from Karen who said, what did Bubba last eat?
Bubba actually ate last Wednesday and he'll eat next Wednesday. So he eats every 2 weeks on Wednesday. He eats 2 large rats.
Okay. So a lot of protein, I guess,
yeah, right?
And a large rat. And who's this little guy?
This is Tater, and he also has a brother named Tot here. So we have Tater and Tot. These are African hedgehogs. And we actually featured Tater on another event that we had. Instead of Groundhog Day, we do Hedgehog Day here at the zoo. It was kind of an ancient tradition that these guys would come out, and same concept of Puxtani Field. If they saw their shadow, they would run back in. If they didn't, they would stay out. So he was actually already on a program once before.
That's really neat.
So, yeah.
How old is Tater?
He's actually fairly young. He's only about a couple years old.
And he looks very prickly, but how do you touch
him?
You
can actually pet him if you want to.
Okay.
But one of their defense mechanisms is to roll up into a ball, hide their eyes and their face and their feet. Their stomach is actually much softer, if you feel right there. A lot softer on the bottom. So they'll roll up into a ball, just put those spines out, and if a predator comes by, they'll kind of puff out to poke them. Mm-hmm. So that's kind of how they protect themselves.
What are their biggest predators in the wild?
There's a lot of different things, but these guys are actually known to eat insects and even snakes and lizards. So these guys can put up a fight all on their own.
Nice. Rob asked, and you probably get this a lot when it comes to hedgehogs.
Right.
Do they run fast? Because everybody thinks of Sonic the Hedgehog.
Right. Yeah, they actually do run pretty fast, and we do have kind of almost like a hamster wheel inside of their enclosure. They are nocturnal animals, so I just kind of woke him up, but he doesn't mind too much right now.
Sorry, Tater.
Checking us all out. But we do have those inside of their enclosures, and they do run pretty quick in those. So
that's
yeah.
really neat. The kids like the hedgehogs too, and feeling because
yeah.
you would think that, I mean, it looks a little prickly, but you think it might be even be softer, but
right.
it's very bristly.
And when these guys are handled quite a lot, so we do have them out so kids can see them up close and personal. So as you can see, he's not threatened by us. He's not puffing out, rolling up into a ball. So that's why his spines kind of feel a little bit softer. But again, yeah, if he rolled up into that ball and really wanted to poke, we would definitely feel that. So.
I got you. You might be wondering, what the heck is all that noise in the background? It's the lorikeets over here. Tell us a little bit about these guys.
So this is Dexter and Lillian. So these two live up here, and again, they go out on programs. We do have a lorikeet aviary on grounds as well, where people can come to the Kansas City Zoo and actually purchase a small cup of the lorikeet nectar that they actually drink. So these guys will actually normally drink from flowers or sweet fruits, so they can feed them on hand, which is really cool.
That's really neat. And so there are so many animals here in the learning den.
Yes.
Amy was asking, which animal do the kids like to play with the most when you go out on the visits?
That's a great question. Usually they're impressed by pretty much any animal. And just like adult kids obviously have their own favorite animals as well. Some really love when we bring big stuff like Bubba out. Some like more of the smaller, cute little mammals that we have. And there's obviously bird lovers and all sorts of different kids out there. So kind of depends on the child, but usually they just like to see animals that we bring out to them.
Nice. Last question for Tater. Katie was asking, is Tater full grown?
Pretty much, yeah. Okay. They usually, these small guys will grow pretty quickly in order, they kind of just leave mom eventually and they just go off on their own. So they need to be large pretty fast so they're able to do that.
Nice. All right. I see we've got another,
yes. So this another guy is, left in line. This is Karai here.
Karai?
She's one of our New Guinea singing dogs. So they come off the island of New Guinea, which is close to Australia. And they're actually one of the rarest dogs in the world. There's only been evidence of photographs of them actually taken twice in the wild. So we don't know population numbers out there in the wild. We really only know that they're out there just by that howl or their sing that they're so known for and what they're named after, as you can kind of hear her sister in the background. What's that? Yeah, we can try to see if she'll sing.
She got her own microphone.
That's right. So they really only detect these guys by research through sonar, so that's how they can tell they're out there in the wild. They're more of a solitary animal, so even here we have two sisters. They don't live together. They do better on their own, and it's very common, like I said, out in the wild as well. They don't live in packs like wolves do. They just live off on their own. But their howl is known to be between a wolf and a whale, so it can go as high pitch as some of the humpback whale sonar that we can actually pick up. So it's really interesting that they have different vocalizations.
And I don't know if it picks up in our microphones, but you can definitely hear her sister.
Yes.
The wide range. She's got good range.
It can get quite loud in the zoo learning den, but
nice.
There's lots of fun things.
You didn't do anything.
She's got stage fright.
A little camera shy, yeah.
That's all right, in front of the lights. But she is so cute, and you said it's her sister, but do they interact a lot, or they...
No, they can see each other, but they don't live together. Like I said, it's more common for them to be solitary or on their own, so that's how we also have them here.
Nice.
And they're about 10 years old. They'll be 11 in October, so they're one of our oldest animals in the building besides the next guy that we're going to meet. So we all get to meet one of our oldest, our largest, and all kinds of different stuff.
Great. Today. You touched on this a little bit, but Frank asked, why do they howl? You said it's more for location sense?
So they howl. They actually communicate across distances to other dogs. Even though they don't live together, they can communicate. So they can harmonize, and you can actually hear them singing together at different pitches, but it wouldn't be right next to each other.
Mm-hmm. Nice. Well, good to see you, pup. Thank you for singing. You passed your audition.
She did.
All right. You know, we go a little bit higher up the tree, I think.
Yeah, right? So this is Raoul. He's a speckled owl, and he's actually our oldest animal here at the Zoo Learning Den. He's going to be 30 years old in March.
Wow.
So he's very old for an owl. He used to be in our Wings of Wonder bird show. We still have that bird show every day at 11:30 and 2:30 in our auditorium at the front of the zoo. But he's retired now since he's a little bit older, but he's still a great education animal to bring out in front of kids.
He's got a nice, cushy retirement job, right?
He
used to hang out with the kids. And they said, Raoul?
Raoul.
Raoul the owl.
Yes.
I like it. Just look at his eyes. That's amazing. Hi. Good to see you, too.
So kind of like glasses or spectacles, that's how they get their name, is with those rings around his eye, kind of look like glasses.
Nice. And so what is Raoul's diet? Mice?
So mice, different types of meat that we feed him. He does eat pretty much every single day, and we weigh that out every day for him, make sure he's getting all the nutrients that he needs.
Nice. Jessica was asking about Raoul's backstory. How did he get to the zoo?
That's a great question. Melissa might know a little bit.
He came to us from another zoo, but I'm not sure.
Okay.
Yeah, it's hard. With our collection in here, it's so diverse. We do sometimes take in unwanted pets or donated animals when people can't take care of them anymore. We usually recommend just do your research before you get any pet, though, so that that doesn't have to be what you need to do with those animals later.
Right.
So make sure you know how large they're going to get, their lifespan, what they need to eat, what type of enclosure they need to have before ever purchasing a pet. But sometimes that does happen, and we take them in here. Others, like she said, come from other zoos or different facilities. Some were born here and hand-raised by us as well. So it just kind of depends on the animal. They all have a different story.
Elizabeth asks, where is Raul like native to? Where would he normally
be? So he's actually, believe it or not, a tropical species of bird that lives more in the rainforest area in South America. So he's actually a warm weathered bird. So he really loved the summer this year being so hot. We could take him out, get him some sunlight.
Mm-hmm. Where is exercise for Ralph? Just right outside? You guys have a...
Yeah, so we have outdoor aviaries for these guys so they can go out when it's nice out. It's even good for them to go out during the rain if it's not storming too hard. It's great for their feather condition to kind of dust off them and all that kind of stuff. But yeah, we do have some outdoor stalls here so you can go outside and hang out there.
Just get some fresh air. Does everybody a little bit of good. Great. The kids like to see Raul too.
Oh, yeah, yeah. They really like the large eyes. It kind of makes him almost look like a stuffed animal. So he's a big hit with pretty much all guests.
They all want to
see him. Yeah, he's one of them.
See him
and
touch
favorites.
Him. Right, exactly. There was a question coming in. Speaking of the eyes, from Avery, who asked, do they see as well as people say they do?
They do. So we kind of compare owl vision. Now, they usually are only nocturnal, so they'd be out at night. Raul's kind of adapted to our schedule here, though. So at night, they can see in very low light from just the moon or the starlight that's out there can get into their eyes and they can see. But we kind of compare it to that. If you had a paperback book and you put it at the end of a football field and it was open, you could read it from the other end. That's how well they can actually see. So they have excellent eyesight.
Oh, my goodness. And so he goes on the school trips as well, right?
Yes, they all do? Yep. He does programs off grounds and on grounds. And we do take a lot of these animals out. We do have animal volunteers and different staff that will take these guys out so that you can see them up close and personal. So you can see that all over the zoo as well.
That's really neat. Well, nice to meet you, Raul, the owl. And tell us a little bit about the room we're into, because we're surrounded by animals. Right,
right. Yes. So we do have three separate rooms in this building. Room one kind of has all of our reptiles. It's very hot in there, which is why we didn't choose to do this
show
there.
Yeah.
But we have a lot of different snakes, our amphibians, our invertebrates are in that room. And this room are kind of our smaller animals, besides Bubba lives in here as well. We need a little more space than what we could have in there. So we have some smaller birds over here. So we have a imperial pigeon. We have a couple lorikeets who are talking about it. Yeah.
They are, yeah.
We have a few sugar gliders that live together. We have some chinchillas. We have a screaming hairy armadillo in this room. Yeah, he's
what a descriptive.
Right, yeah. He does exactly that, yeah. We have two hedgehogs, and then we have four star tortoises as well. So we are surrounded by a lot of
animals. Nice. Can we go see the tortoises
real quick? So we kind of named these guys after the Ninja Turtles. So we have all four here. So this is Donatello. We have Raphael in here. We have Leonardo and Michelangelo on that side. So this is pretty much full grown for a star tort. They don't get very large. They're from India, so they're an Indian star tortoise.
Wow, the shell is
amazing. Yeah, you can kind of see the different star shapes is how they get their name, just those different markings. Mm-hmm. And even though, I mean, they all do look pretty much identical, you can tell them apart in slight ways. The one on the left's a little bit wider than the one on the right. This one on the right has kind of a hole on the back right here.
Oh, okay. Yeah, a little bit.
Marking. And then this one's is actually filled in. So
you really
very
have to,
slight.
You have to concentrate to tell them apart.
So when we do have animals living together that look kind of similar like this, we do have identification charts with their photographs so that we can tell who is who when we take them on program.
So you'd have to put like bandanas on them,
right,
like the
Ninja
Turtles.
We probably should, though. Because...
Yeah, this might be a good idea, right? Well, Jessica, thank you so
yes,
much for
no
showing
problem.
Us around the Animal Den. Thank you so much for asking questions. ZooView is next week here on the KNBC9 Facebook page, so make sure you tune in. And thanks for watching, everyone. That's great. I mean, these are really cool little guys too.